Good morning. Welcome to the Kauffman FastTrac author series. My name is Alana Mueller, and I'm the president of Kauffman FastTrac. It's my pleasure to have all of you here this morning for our inaugural author series talk. Today's speaker, Noam Wasserman, is a professor at Harvard Business School. For more than a decade, his research has focused on founders' early decisions that can make or break the startup and its team. At HBS, he developed and teaches an MBA elective called The Founder's Dilemmas, for which he was awarded the HBS Faculty Teaching Award. In 2011, the course was also named one of the top entrepreneurship courses in the country by Inc. magazine. His book, The Founder's Dilemmas, Anticipating and Avoiding the Pitfalls That Can Sink a Startup, was published in March and quickly became a bestseller, and is the latest book in the Kauffman Foundation series on innovation and entrepreneurship. It's my pleasure on behalf of Kauffman FastTrac to have Noam kick off our author series today. And with that, I will turn the microphone over to him. Welcome, Noam.
Hey, thank you, Alana. I really appreciate your having me. Looking forward to spending the next hour delving into a bunch of those key founder dilemmas that you were just mentioning. I'm going to start off with a happy topic, that topic being entrepreneurial failure, something that we all wring our hands about, the very high rate of failure within startups, and it feels like it's something that we really can't do much about, but that we're hopefully going to be able to get deeply into one of the key reasons for failure and be able to start seeing some actionable things that we can do, especially from the beginning of the journey if we are aware of where that road is going to be going, for us to be able to get our hands around it and actually be able to do something that enables us to reduce that entrepreneurial failure and increases the chances that we're going to be able to have the impact on the world that we want to have, be able to have the dreams come true that we head into when we become entrepreneurs. To get into that, to be able to get our arms around this very hard to get our to define problem, I'm going to reach back to a paper that motivated my research. It was something that was published a quarter of a century ago by someone who's now a close colleague of mine, Bill Salmon here at the business school, where Bill was going in to understand a whole bunch of things inside the black box of venture capital firms. And he went and tried to understand how they make investments, how they evaluate them, how they do due diligence once they have made an investment, how they work with their companies. And along the way, he also thought to ask, fortunately, about the parts of their portfolio that we never hear about, that today the VCs would never feature on their websites, would never issue press releases about, those being the parts of their portfolio that have failed, the startups that ended up going bankrupt or having some kind of bad outcome for them. And Bill went in to try to categorize those reasons for failure. Why did those things happen when it was all the highest potential startups that were being invested in? And they went in with their already having thoughts about what those sources of failure were going to be. And they found indeed that a bunch of those were on the list. They had to do with what today we would call product market fit problems, or problems within the different functions within the company, or financial issues. And what they found was that those reasons were indeed about 35%. They were definitely evident there within the reasons for failure. But what they found very surprising, and it's a key piece, it's to me the most important paragraph of their paper, the most important data point in one of their tables, is what was by far the number one reason for failure within those ventures. And what they found was that 65% of those were the people problems. It was the interpersonal tensions between the founders during the early days, then the issues that arose as hires were being injected into the startup to complement the founding team as it was growing or as there were holes to fill, and that at its core, those people problems were the reasons why these highest potential startups were failing. And one of the key problems is that early on, especially when it comes to a whole bunch of those people issues, but more generally within our startups as we're founding, a big problem is that we have no real roadmap. It looks like chaos for where we are heading into as we embark on our entrepreneurial journey. And that when we lack that clear roadmap, that there are several things we have to rely on as we're making decisions, as we're at those key forks in the road. We're following our gut and our intuition during the early passionate days. We are listening to the anecdotes that are out there, the prominent founders and how they went about doing things, the rules of thumb that we hear from others about how we're supposed to go and do things. And one of the key things that I found in my research, what I've done over the last dozen years, is shine the light of data on these anecdotes, this intuition, the rules of thumb that we are following, to be able to see where is it good to follow our heart, but at the same time, where is it counterproductive to do so. My favorite Steve Jobs quote is, follow your heart, but check it with your head. And that unfortunately, during those early stages of the journey, when we don't understand what are going to be down the road implications of key ways that we're following our gut and our intuition, where we should think twice about it, where we should make sure that we are checking that passion and that intuition with that journey ahead and having knowledge of it, that going and creating that roadmap and identifying those key inflection points where we have to think twice before we go and make that leap. That's what I have focused on, and that's where we're going to take a couple of pieces today at being able to understand those things. And so in particular, when it comes to the data side of what I tap, both within my course and within the book, that I've gone in and over the last dozen years collected data from a whole bunch of almost 4,000 startups. These in particular are from the two biggest industries. This is just to give people out there who are not from those industries a little bit of a context so that we can start having a little bit of thinking and a dialogue around how it might be different for their contexts. But it's focusing on the two largest industries for high potential startups, those being the high tech industry and the life sciences industry. And tapping data on 10,000 founders, their backgrounds, the early decisions that they made, the path and the outcomes that they saw ahead as they were starting to see the outcomes that were caused by those early decisions. And so we're going to be tapping, you'll see several slides along the way where we're going to be tapping a bunch of that data. We'll also complement it, my, of course, being from HBS, there's no way that I would be able to get out the building at night if I didn't go and tap some case studies. But it's also invaluable to be able to go into what I tap is 36 cases worth of getting inside the founders' heads, understanding what they were thinking about as they were facing those forks in the road, understanding the dynamics within the team, the much deeper, richer element, being able to get into it in the actual stories around those founders, where we can complement that with the data and be able to really draw out a bunch of those lessons. And during the webinar, we'll tap a couple of quick case studies as we get into understanding what the founders were thinking early on and where things were led, how the decisions that they made affected the dynamics within the team. And so during the webinar, we'll be taking both of these sides, the quantitative and the qualitative, the cases, to be able to paint a picture of a whole bunch of these steps along the way. Let's just start out at the high level about the core dilemmas that founders are facing throughout these forks in the road. Some of the most important of those are even before you found a bunch of the pre-founding decisions that introduce pitfalls down the road after you've gone and launched your venture. For this, I'm going to rely on the Kauffman resource that's been developed. We're not going to have time to cover the most important of those pre-founding pitfalls. But if you want help thinking through a bunch of them, the Kauffman Foundation has developed a short sketchbook that will help being able to anticipate a whole bunch of the key ways in which those early passionate days of evaluating whether to leap and a whole bunch of the ways in which we have to make sure to cover the key bases, in particular in three arenas, the market circumstances, the career circumstances, and the personal circumstances, how to be able to think through a bunch of those issues. But as I mentioned, we're going to focus far more on assuming that you've evaluated that well, and then now as we're going and we're going to be leaping into making that the founding journey, a bunch of those forks in the road along the way. A key thing to take a look at through the lens of the people problems we were talking about on that early slide is that at each of these key forks in the road, we are injecting in a brand new player into the equation. After the core founder has gone and made that decision that it's time to leap, injecting in the possibility of co-founders, that leads to a bunch of other decisions, ways in which there's new decisions, new dynamics that will introduce, new potential for the venture, but also new risks that are going to be added to it. And so being able to understand how to think through adding in that key person, then after that, when there are non-founding hires, sometimes coming with very different skills, sometimes with very different incentives and motivations, how to think through that decision about whether to inject in those hires. Likewise, the next step along the way, injecting in the investors where they're going to have some real potential to add value to the venture, but also are coming at things from a very different perspective. There might be the potential for misalignment. How can we resolve a bunch of those issues? And so at each of these key forks in the road, we're adding in brand new players, and that's heightening the chances that you're going to have that 65% problem of those people issues that are going to lead to major problems within the team and within the venture. And across these key forks in the road, in the book, in my course, I cover more than 24 of those key dilemmas that you'll face as a founder. During our time together now, I'm only going to have time to delve deeply into two of them, but they'll hopefully give us a broader set of issues to think about as you're seeing a bunch of those other forks in the road and as you're involving those other people, in particular, the co-founders and the investors that are going to be what we're going to be delving into. So to start off there within the founding team part, now we're going to assume that the light bulb has gone off. We're going to take a look at one of the earliest and most important of those decisions that you face on the people side. As you head to this fork in the road, you could either go upwards. You could make the decision to try to be Superman, to try to be the solo founder, to take the weight of the world onto your broad shoulders as you go and attempt to leap that building with a single bound all by yourself. Or you could decide to go and go down the bottom fork here to go and inject in co-founders. From a data perspective, the top option to become a solo founder is very much the exception within my data. Only 16% of the ventures in my data set were solo founded. It is far more the case that people head down the bottom fork here. Heading down that bottom fork of injecting in more co-founders leads to a bunch of ripple decisions that you will then face as you're deciding who are you going to tap, as you're deciding how you're going to involve them in the venture, and having a negotiation and a dialogue about how you're going to be splitting up several things. We're going to refer to the three in particular that we're going to focus on for the next three slides as the three R's. Those are going to be the relationships that you're tapping, the roles and decision making that you're going to be allocating within the venture, and the rewards that you're going to be going and also looking at how you're going to allocate it within the ventures. And so being able to delve into those briefly, we're going to take a look at these three R's. Within the relationships one, just to frame a couple of the key choices that people face, we could go and tap the co-founders with whom we already have social relationships. We could go and tap the friends that are the very logical and, as it turns out, the very common place that people look for possible co-founders. This is another common pattern across the forks in the road that I examine. The most common of the decisions that founders make are often the most fraught with peril. They're often the ones that could lead you to glory, co-founding with friends or with family, the couplepreneur that you might become when you're tapping your significant other, that co-founding with those people that you have those prior social relationships could be the most glorious of teams, and that's very much what we wish for and anticipate when we are early on tapping those people. But those are also the ones that the data show are also the ones with the highest potential for disaster. And in particular, it's because the personal can often conflict with business decisions. That often leads us to do several things that are different when we are tapping the social relationships, when we are going to be heading into co-founding with them, as opposed to tapping the prior professional relationships, the people that but we don't have initially a social basis for working together, but where we're coming together, having more of a professional way in which we are architecting our relationship and then building the team upon that relationship. And there are often people that start out as our professional coworkers, and then we develop close relationships with them. But that is a very different animal. It's a very different set of things that are enabled compared to our starting out with a social relationship and then trying to architect a professional one on top of that. And in particular, across these very different types of relationships, we might have a different way in which we are willing or try to avoid discussing the tension-filled issues. Are the elephants in the room going to be things that we're going to intentionally bring up with our co-founders, or are we going to try to avoid bringing those up? And that's going to differ by whether it's friends and family we're founding with or the prior co-workers. Also, what kind of an amount of damage could we be causing to our most treasured of relationships if the startup hits a major bump in the road? That's going to be very different by if we're co-founding with friends and family, those prior social relationships, or co-founding with acquaintances or co-founding with prior coworkers. And because of those very different things across those relationships, it's what I term the playing with fire issue that you often face when you are tapping different types of relationships, where it could either be playing with fire forges a stronger team, that glorious team that we are hoping for, or it could be that playing with fire ends up blowing up the team. And there are very actionable steps that we can take to be able to hopefully protect ourselves from the disastrous outcome, so we can increase the chances that we're going to be able to achieve the glory that we want. And so that's within the relationships part. We're going to have to move on to the next of the R's, but it's a key place to be thinking about those early decisions you're making and some of those outcomes that we often don't think as hard about because we're looking at rosy scenarios and hoping for the glory. And it's a similar thing as we're heading into the second of the R's, the roles and decision-making and how we architect it. Taking a look first at one of those models, we can think about Peter Pan and where Peter Pan lived. Peter Pan lived in Neverland. The defining characteristic of Neverland is that it was all children there, that there were no grown-ups. We are all on the same level. We are all on the same playing field. Within startups, we have a great euphemism for that approach and that way that we've structured the venture. We tend to call it things like we are co-CEOs within the venture. We're making decisions by consensus. That is, during those early days, a very common way that founders go and architect the roles and decision-making within their teams. It's a very different approach compared to what we might call the Mount Olympus approach. We are Zeus up top, at the top of the mountain, above everyone else. It is very clear where the buck stops. Zeus handing down orders to those below at the bottom of the mountain. Very clear hierarchy within the organization. And that's an alternate model that people can adopt within their teams. One of the key things, and this is another piece that this highlights, about the early decisions that you might make that early on are the right way to go, but without having an idea for where the long term is going to take us, that in the long run, those early, easy, logical decisions might be a bad thing, a hard thing to undo, and increase the chances that you're going to have and heighten the tensions within the venture. For instance, if you start out in Neverland, and then as growth hits, as you hit 20 people within the venture, as consensus and as co-CEO is breaking down, maybe slowing you down, and you might have to move to more of a Mount Olympus model or some hybrid between the two of them, is that a very easy transition to make? It is very often a very jarring transition and one that heightens the tensions within the team and leads to major challenges along the way. If there are ways that you can anticipate that you're going to have to go through that transition, there are other ways to architect those early days and to have Neverland set you up to have a better transition rather than having that jarring transition that it might cause. So now that you've gone and you've allocated the roles and the decision-making across the team, the last of the R's is the rewards. The key piece within this is, how are you going to be splitting the equity? How are you going to be sharing the ownership within the team? That, of course, most easy of discussions that you're ever going to have with your team, the negotiation that you very much look forward to having as a founder. If it could be that, then that would be terrific. As it turns out, it's exactly the opposite. It is often the most tension-filled of those issues, and that leads to several challenges for the team. And this is the piece that we're going to be delving in most deeply into within the founding team part, the equity split. We're going to take a look both at the data and also at a couple of mini cases around that. But before we move on to that, just a step back a moment to take a look again at the bigger picture. Across these three R's, we've already discussed a little bit, but there's key things to understand within each of the R's about better and worse decisions that you could be making, and also that you have to make with a long-term understanding the road ahead perspective rather than just a short-term where we stand right now. However, in addition to these being individual decisions that you make, they are also linked to each other, and those linkages can heighten the tensions even when the individual decisions seem to be right. But if it's not looked at as these decisions have to be consistent with each other, that's where we're going to potentially be causing problems and heightening the tensions within the team. So for instance, if you are going to become a couplepreneur, co-founding with your significant other, you are then going to architect it that you're going to be co-CEOs making decisions by consensus, but then you come to the table and you say, honey, I'm worth two-thirds of the pie. I'm going to be the bigger contributor here. I'm going to be more committed to the venture. Is that going to be a recipe for smooth relationships, or is that going to be, because of its being in the constellation of the other R's, is that going to be heightening the tensions given who you decided to co-found with and how you architected the relationships, the roles, and the decision-making within the team? And so thinking hard about these as a constellation of decisions, also there's a natural human inclination, as I referred to in brief before with the equity split, that there's very much a natural inclination to avoid conflict, to not bring up these tension-filled issues, to hope that they will solve themselves, to punt them down the road, and to avoid discussing the elephants in the room that are looming, that are potentially going to cause destruction for us, but that we don't want to bring up because of the people that we co-founded with or the other inclination that we're going to have to avoid conflict. And because of that, each of these three R's very much have elements of that elephant in the room, and there are several ways in which punting on those, and we'll see this within the rewards discussion that we're about to have, can cause major problems for a team rather than going and tackling them when you are still during the early days, when it's not tension-filled, when it's not a gun forcing you to, that's staring you in the face as you're going to have to deal with these tension-filled relationships, roles, and rewards issues. So now heading into the rewards part, the equity splits, I'm going to go back to a data point on a very common decision. That is that 73% of ventures split the equity right at the beginning. They split it within a month of founding. Think about whether that is a good or bad decision to make, a bunch of the trade-offs that are involved in there and balances and stuff. We're going to take a look right now at first the data on the next data point about equity splits, but then get into a case study about one of those 73% of teams and where that led to, and then we will complement that with another case study that's a distinctly different model that they follow. And so first, with regards to the equity splits, this is the pie chart of the degree to which splits are equal or not. During those 73% of ventures, those early days, it's actually much more common, even more common than the biggest slice here on the chart, that teams go and split the equity equally. They follow the 1/n rule. They do 50-50. They do a third, a third, a third if it's three co-founders. That is very much a bigger slice, the equal split, when you are doing it during those very early days. Let's take a look at one of those teams that did make that very common decision to split during that 73%, the first month of their founding. This is a company that is now very prominent. The early days, it was a Boston-based company, Zipcar, that was founded by two women. The two of them knew each other socially. Their kids had shared a daycare center, and while waiting for the kids to get out or during the interactions that they had during those drop-offs and pickups, the two women who ended up co-founding Zipcar got to know each other a little bit. One of them had been in Europe, had seen a car sharing service there. Also, in addition to seeing it as a good business opportunity, the two women very much had a green inclination, very much had an interest in improving the environment, that they thought here, great business idea and the potential to improve things in the U.S. in the environmental realm. And so they decided, let's go and see if we can make this into a company. Let's go have this high impact idea that we can go and have an impact on the world. And the two of them went forward during those early days. And one of them, Robin Chase, had heard a horror story from a friend about what the equity split negotiation had done for that person's venture, and had heard about the major tensions that it introduced and caused a derailing of that other venture. And so she'd heard this anecdote and decided, I want to make sure that that's not going to be the thing that gets in the way of our going out and conquering the world and having the impact that we want to have. And so they proposed and they went ahead and split it 50-50, the 1/n quick handshake. And Robin thought, great, we got that out of the way. Now the world is ours to go off and conquer. Over the next year and a half, Robin threw herself into the venture. She devoted herself at least full time, if not more, to crafting the business plan, to creating the partnerships with car companies and all of the other things that that had to go into building Zipcar. And her co-founder didn't even quit her day job, didn't come on board, at best was contributing from the sidelines. And if we think about in Robin's head a year and a half later, what is she feeling along the way? This is very much where you could see when Robin came and visited class and was talking about the implications of that early split, you could see it eating her up in her face. You could see the angst that she talked about that it had caused for her. about the hard work that she was having to go through and her co-founder benefiting equally from that hard work when it came to the financial side and not even investing all of the things that was needed to get that equal financial gain. And she talked about the key things that we made rosy assumptions about early on, and then there are all sorts of ways that our assumptions were wrong, where we had much bigger uncertainties than we were assuming during those early passionate days, and that who knows along the way how that most stupid of the handshakes that I made was going to cause major angst for me down the road. And so she was talking about the experience that you are opening yourself up to, the risk that you are taking when you are that 73% of ventures. One other key data point is that among those ventures that are splitting it early on, more than half of them do not include any dynamic element, do not include vesting, do not include any way to adjust as key things are happening down the road. And because of that, Robin, who had set her equity split in concrete, had major problems that were caused by that. There are major ways in which you have a real problem moving away from that early anchoring, away from those early agreements that you crafted, real inertia that is caused by them, on the legal side and expectations that were set and things like that. And so that is part of those early origins of that angst that we will hopefully help you be able to avoid, both within the equity split, but then more broadly as you're making these early decisions that seem to be the right ones, that are often driven by the rosy scenarios we're looking at, the passionate decisions we're making, but also the anecdotes that we've heard and the rules of thumb that we're following, that can then, down the road, cause major problems and angst for us. To complement that, let's take a look at a venture from the other side of this pie chart. This is a venture called Occam Technologies. This was three prior coworkers who were coming together to co-found. They also, within that prior coworker set of relationships, they'd also had one of them who was reporting to another one of those co-founders, so a distinct subordinate. It was very clear that they were going to be bringing different amounts of value to the venture, different contributions that they were going to be making. And so early on, they went and tackled a bunch of the difficult discussions about how are we going to be having different contributions to the venture, and went ahead and had that dialogue that ended up with their adoption of an unequal split. It was very clear that one of them was going to be contributing more than another, so they're going to be having differential things that should be acknowledged in the amount of equity that they're each going to have. But to me, the more key element is the second one that they added in. Rather than just looking at the rosy scenario, which is something that they did discuss, they also went and forced themselves to look at the biggest uncertainties that they faced, the ones that Robin and her co-founder had avoided discussing, didn't want to bring up those elephants in the room about when we hit a pothole, when we are scaling and one of us is not able to keep up with it, when there are certain things that might lead one of us to have commitment issues, all sorts of things that that there's a natural tendency to avoid, that they went and tackled those up front. And to go back to my long-buried background as a computer engineer, when I saw their founding agreement, the Occam founding agreement, I saw a series of if-then-else statements. And this was the scenarios that Occam went into about their biggest uncertainty. They focused on the biggest uncertainty within their team. That was that the core idea person, the guy, would come up with the idea, a guy named Ken, that there was big uncertainty about whether he was going to be joining and to what extent he was going to be joining. The same kind of outcome that Zipcar had faced with the co-founder, that Occam went and tackled that uncertainty. Ken had just become a first-time father as they were writing the business plan. He wasn't sure if this new family life is going to be compatible with this new founding life that I've never embarked on. He also had a day job that he really liked. He wasn't sure if he was going to be quitting from it or not. And so the Occam team did a deep dive into first the rosy scenario, and the first of those things that I saw in their founding agreement was if the rosy scenario happens, if Ken is on board full time, then this is what the equity split is going to be. Else, if the expected scenario happens, the expectation was that he would be contributing at least a bit to the venture. If that expected scenario happens, then this is what the equity split will be. Else, if worst case scenario happens, that being that Ken is not on board at all, is a dropout co-founder, then these are the buyout terms by which we can go and reclaim his equity rather than having it become dead equity with all sorts of problems that causes, that we're going to be able to reclaim it if he's not on board at all contributing to the venture. And they had that deep discussion about not only the rosy scenario, but also the bumps in the road, a critical thing to be understanding what are those potential bumps, and to be making sure that you understand that those key uncertainties that we face, that we should do a deep dive into it, have a substantive discussion about it, see the implications for the business, see the implications for the team, that as we head into it, that we should make sure that those uncertainties are matched by dynamism within the agreements that we are crafting early on. And this is particularly critical during those very early days of the startup. You can go and create the static agreement that Zipcar did if you have a whole bunch of things that you are sure about. For instance, at the level of the venture, if you are sure that you know your business model, if you are sure that your strategy is all stabilized very early on, if you are sure that you're not going to be one of those prototypical ventures that is going to go through three pivots along the way to finding its final business model and honing its strategy, then great, you can put a check mark next to these. Then within the team, if you are not sure about, because of those potential changes in strategy and business model, what skills are we going to need? What are the different roles that each of us are going to be playing with each of those possible changes in strategy and business model? If those are all set and you could put check marks there also, then great. At more personal level, if each of these, especially when you're a first-time founder who has never gone through the bottom of the entrepreneurial roller coaster, when the world is crashing in on you and you are not sure if you're going to be able to persist through it, if you can be sure that you're going to persist, if you can be sure about your co-founders and have the knowledge that they're also going to be able to make it through that, if you can put a check mark there, if there are going to be no personal uncertainties for anyone about no health issues that might strike, like some of our iconic teams, the Microsoft team, for example, got hit by a major life-threatening illness that caused the co-founder to drop out of the venture. If you can be sure that with all of these things you can put check marks there, then I will give you a big thumbs up to go and set things in concrete like what Zipcar did. However, I would make the argument, we could take a show of hands right now, how many people during the early stages of their venture could put check marks on all of these? And we would probably be able to get not a single hand in the air that you were able to be confident that all of this was well defined. And if so, if you can't put check marks in all of these, then you have to think far more about that kind of dynamic split that is going to be able to adjust to those uncertainties as they might hit. We're never going to be able to go and remove all of the uncertainties within a venture. But if we can go and remove as many of them as possible, and then have those teams be able to have had those uncertainties removed from those bumps in the road that they're going to hit and be able to craft robust agreements that are going to be able to adjust to them, then terrific. If we are going to still face those remaining uncertainties for the remainder of those teams, those early dialogues are a critical thing to go and have as you're honing as a team. How do we work together through tough issues, getting to know each other and understand each other? In some ways, the worst case scenario is that you hold off for 6 months or so on the equity split, a deep dialogue that surfaces different interests, that surfaces real ideas about who's going to be committed to it and the roles that we expect ourselves each to have. And if you've punted on that, if you've held off like what they did within Zipcar, and you don't have that deep dialogue early on where you might be able to surface that we're not compatible, that we shouldn't be working together, and instead you go 6 months, you plow your life into it and you develop a whole bunch, and then you find that out, that we shouldn't be working together, that to me is the worst case scenario. And it's far more the case that early on, have that dialogue, also make sure that you're having the dynamic side, that you are doing a deep dive into the uncertainties, then make sure you're crafting those agreements to be able to have those bumps in the road, not heighten the tensions within the team, but hopefully be able to make sure that it's going to be a much more smooth process than what Robin had within Zipcar. And so if we step back just within the founding team as we close the loop on this about some of those common issues that we've seen, it's during those key early passionate days when we have lots of confidence in the venture and in ourselves that we're making key early decisions that are often driven by gut, by instinct, that are driven by the anecdotes that we've heard about, just like it was with Robin. And then when we layer on any one of these as heightening the chances that we're going to hit those key problems that we've seen, and then we complement it with the elephants in the room that we're hopefully going to be able to tackle but tend to avoid, that conflict avoidance, a very natural human inclination, but that can be disastrous when it comes to the three R's, that is when, if we take a look at this constellation of these patterns of going and making decisions when these are the things that are driving it, rather than our understanding of the road ahead and understanding of what is the preponderant set of outcomes that are going to be caused, what is the norm, rather than just assuming that we're going to be able to be the outlier, that is just them who hit the bumps in the road that Robin did and that the core set of the data says are the most common outcomes. Go and do that deep dive into assuming that that expected case is going to be us. And let's tackle those other bumps in the road when it comes to the worst case scenarios. Also, making sure that what we're going to be architecting within the team is not going to be a recipe for tension, but is hopefully going to be able to forge a stronger team rather than causing that team to blow up. So now as we head into the investor dilemmas, we're going to be taking a look at this key fork of adding in this next player. We're going to be doing a dive into this that is going to look in some ways has some very much parallels to the prior chart that we took a look at where we're looking at the team forks in the road. This is what we're making that decision about the financing side and what we're going to do on the capital raising or not. That initial fork in the road heading upwards has a lot of parallels to Superman that we saw earlier. This is the decision to do it yourself, the decision to bootstrap your venture, to, on the financing side, rely on the seed of the money that you had saved or on internally generated cash as you're going forward. And that, for some people and for some ventures, is a very legitimate option to go and take. But as you go and head down the bottom fork here, injecting in investors, not doing it all yourself, there's going to be, again, several ripple decisions that you're going to be facing of key things you're going to have to decide that are introduced just by heading down that bottom fork in the road. The first of those is going to be the who are you going to take money from. There's also implications for the roles and decision-making, and then parallels to other implications of those early decisions that you're going to be facing. Now, the next three slides, we're going to go into each of those. And so the first that has parallels to the relationships, the sources that you're tapping for co-founders, who are you going to tap when you're going to take money from? The prototypical extremes that people talk about and that have some real implications what we're going to talk about next are the decision of, am I going to take the smartest of smart money or am I going to take the dumbest of dumb money? Am I going to go with the people whose dollar is just the green that is on the dollar bill? Or am I going to go with the people who are going to be adding value beyond the dollar bill, or are going to be able to potentially fill in key holes that I have, who are going to be able to take some of the remaining challenges that I face in terms of the contacts that I don't have, in terms of the dollars that I don't have, in terms of the human capital that I don't know how to get to and be able to bring those people on? And so that difference in who you're going to be taking the money from has some real implications for the potential you're going to be able to build within the venture, but also introducing some risks into it. And in particular, who you're taking money from has some real implications for a key decision-making body that's at the top of the venture, so, and several key decisions that the board of directors is going to be controlling, things like the next rounds of financing, things like the major strategic shifts that you might go through, the timing and how you are going to be exiting from it. But often the most momentous decision for the founder personally, and also a critical inflection point for the venture, the board controlling who is going to be CEO of the venture, controlling whether they're going to be keeping on board or whether they're going to be replacing that founder as the CEO of the venture. Why do boards go and change that CEO? Interestingly, even the most successful of founder CEOs, my data and the research show, are often replaced by the board. Often when the board believes going forward that the next stage of the venture, this person who was the perfect person to be leading us until now, the key challenges that we face going forward, is not going to be the right person for us, that the real value has to be built by someone whose skills are different or who is not so tied to those early decisions and people who are on board. Critical things for founders to, and I devote an entire chapter because it's such a critical inflection point, to understanding what are the developments within the venture, the key successes and milestones that you hit, and that actually heighten the chances that you're going to be replaced as CEO of the venture, something that I call the paradox of entrepreneurial success, that not only does failure as a CEO lead to your replacement, but also very much success when you are quick to those milestones, when you have led the venture to raising key rounds of financing, that big success that we celebrate, those happen to heighten the chances that you're going to be replaced. But the argument that's often given to founders is if you step aside if you go and take a different role within the venture, or find a different way in which you can translate your skills and your love outside of being CEO, if you can bring in a brand new CEO who's going to be the better person to grow the value of the venture, you'll be richer for it. You will be having a richer equity stake. For a lot of founders, when they hear that, they recoil from that. They hear that message as being what they refer to as a ton of bricks hitting me, or when a very prominent founder CEO, Jack Dorsey, the founder CEO of Twitter, said that it was like being punched in the stomach when he heard that. Even the founders who are hearing that message of, hey, you'll become richer for having given up being parent of your baby, it is a jarring transition. There's a very visceral reaction to that, and it is very much one that is make or break for the venture, if this can be a smooth transition, or make or break for the founder when it comes to that key fork in the road that they're facing. And going to the data, this is my data on the percentage of founders who are still CEO as the venture is evolving. Down along the bottom, from zero at founding up through when the venture is aging up to 100 months of life. As we go on the vertical axis, up at the top, 100% of the founders who are still CEO. And then as the venture is evolving, as we go across to the right of this chart, that is the percentage of founders who are still CEO. And we see how it's dropping off along the way. To take one metric, after the third, when ventures have raised their third round of financing, 52% of the founders have been replaced as CEO, more than half of them at that critical point in the life of the venture. And of those who have been replaced, nearly three quarters of them have been fired. It's been board-initiated replacement. It is very much the exception that the founder is going and raising that hand and saying, I'm seeing that road ahead. I'm seeing and evaluating whether I'm the right person for it. And some of those are saying, I'm maybe not the right person for it, inviting the board into that dialogue and initiating the discussion about whether I should find a better role, go back to my first love, whether it's the technical love that I had and I've seen some of the painful things within what it means to be CEO, et cetera, or very much the exception that it's the board having to push and force that change in a very make or break way for the venture. And when we go back to that argument that the board would be making at that point, is that the founder is at that key fork in the road. We could be choosing whether you're going to remain king of the venture, whether you're going to remain on that throne, or whether you're going to become a lesser player within the venture, giving up the throne, but with the potential for you to become richer because of it. That at the venture level, we're going to be more valuable. At the personal financial stake level, you're going to have a richer stake within the venture. There might be a higher chance that we're going to be able to exit other things that might be enabled at the key fork in the road, but that the founder is at that point facing a critical, what I call rich versus king choice, of trading off that control versus being able to attract those key resources and bring on the person who's going to be able to grow the value of the venture. Excuse me, and as we look at a whole bunch of those, as we pull together now, a bunch of the things that we've been talking about, a bunch of those key forks in the road that founders are facing as they're making these decisions on the people side, we can go and take, after the light bulb has gone off, that line that we had seen about founders giving up control of the venture, and that bottom path, we're going to trace through how that might compare to the decisions that you're going to make as you go across the top path. And so as we look at, after the light bulb has gone off, the founder decision about whether to attract co-founders or not, you could be Superman, go the solo route, and keep yourself at the point of having 100% control of the venture, or you could go down the route of bringing on the co-founders, attracting the best of them, and bringing on the people to help you grow that value. Then as you head into the next stage of it, you could decide on the financing side to still remain a bootstrapping founder, do it all yourself and remain solo, not invite other players into the board and into the other key realms of decision making. Or you could go with the richest of the money you could attract from the value-added investors who are going to help you grow the value of the venture. You could then head into the hiring decision. Am I going to attract the jack of all trades, or am I going to go to the been there, done that specialist who's going to really be able to execute and help us create the value that the jack of all trades is not going to be as good at doing? By the way, there are key early decisions that you might make that are very valid early on about the flexible jacks of all trades, ways in which they can play a key role in building that venture. But along the way, as you're transitioning more to getting the been there, done that specialist, key forks in the road that you're going to face, key transitional issues as you're hiring them in above your key early loyal employees. And so key forks in the road that you're going to face within that hiring side. Then as we head into the next of the rounds that you're going to be raising, remaining a bootstrapper versus going and getting the best of those investors on board. And as we go through these decisions that accumulate along the way, these very different paths are going to heighten the chances that you're going to get to very different outcomes. As we go along that top path, soloing, bootstrapping, that's where it's going to lead to you're still having 100% of the venture. You're going to own the whole pie, but it is potentially going to be a smaller pie, a smaller cake because of the decisions that you made to do it all yourself. As you head down the bottom of these paths, attracting the best of the people, the best of the resources to fill in your holes, to be able to tackle this opportunity to its fullest. As you're going down that path, you're potentially going to have a much bigger pie because of having done that, but you will have headed down, imperiling your control of the venture, and that you're going to be betting on, if you go with that argument that we talked about before, of having a bigger slice. Hopefully the pie has grown enough that that smaller slice for you is going to be more financially rewarding than the small cupcake that you owned 100% of. We go now to the data about these two very different promised lands. This is my data on hundreds of ventures and the founders, the value of the founder's equity stake. And over at the right end of this chart, that is where the founders typically went across the top path. They kept control throughout. They were more likely to bootstrap and make those other decisions that kept them in the CEO seat. On the left side, that is where they went down that bottom path, where they decided to bring on those other people, where they went ahead and attracted the money and the resources and gave up the throne potentially. And to the extent that they went ahead and made those very different decisions, they ended up in a very different place. The equity stake of the founder at the right end of this chart is just about half as valuable as the equity stake of the founder at the left end of this chart. If we get into a bunch of the ways, how can we make decisions about whether we want to be at the right end or the left end? Think about several of the inputs that should come into that. There should be elements of the venture, what it needs. Is it cap intensive? Is this an industry that has a real competitive rush? Is this a land grab? Is there a window of opportunity that's going to be slamming shut if we don't move quickly, if we go slower? And that at the venture level should be entering into the equation. But also the founder and which of these promised lands the founder wants to get to should also be a key consideration, the founder's motivations as being a critical input into that decision. If we think about those differences in motivations and these promised lands that we're seeing, those potential outcomes on this chart, think about over on the left that outcome of you gave up the throne, but you got richer for it. If someone was motivated by financial gains, then if they're looking at that outcome, they're thrusting their fists in the air. They are celebrating getting to where they wanted to get to. If we think about that picture of success and what that person would declare a success, and now complement it, contrast it to a founder who is, again, at the left side with having given up control but having gotten richer for it, but that founder, during the early days, I am the visionary. I want to make sure that my idea comes to fruition. I want to see the impact, the direct impact that I can have with my idea on the world, that I want to be keeping control of those decisions that are going to be affecting it. If that founder who was prioritizing, who was more driven by that vision and that control, ends up at the left here, is that founder going to consider that a success? Very likely that that founder is going to be at the other extreme in terms of seeing that outcome as, I would give up that financial success to have been able to have that impact on the world that I could be able to see that is my idea that is going out there and having that impact. And so very different definitions of success. And critical things as an input, as I mentioned, the motivators and where founders are coming out in terms of what is really making them tick and making them go into this early decision to go and bring the weight of the world on their shoulders and build something from scratch. Within the data on motivations, let's focus on the entrepreneurial motivations. If we take a look within men at what are the top motivators, this is across thousands of people who are answering this survey about, and this is ranking across 13 potential motivators, what are the top ones? If we take a look within men, think about what is driving those top motivators there. Number one through three, control-related things, what we would call king motivations. King, 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 and then rich as that motivation at number four. That is highlighting the preponderance of these motivators for entrepreneurs on average. We will find other entrepreneurs who are motivated by some of the things that are lower down on the list, but across the broad spectrum of male entrepreneurs, those are the motivators. If we look at the women, there's a couple of key differences there, but at the top, there's still that control element, the queen at the top of this. Then at number four, what really counts in life. And then at number nine, way down there, is rich. And if we think about first two of those key differences across the genders, which one of these genders is going to find it easier at a jarring fork in the road of trading off rich versus king? We saw how at each of those forks in the road, you're going to have to choose between keep control and not be able to bring those resources and people on, or bring those people on and imperil that control. Men, if it's trading off something's high on our list for another thing that's very high on our list, that's going to be a much harder decision for them to make. Versus for women at those key forks in the road, if you're trading off number one versus number nine, there should be a clearer path ahead. Also, when it comes to that altruism entering in what really counts in life, men, that doesn't enter their motivation set, their top four, until they hit their 40s. Women catch on to that as being the thing that counts 20 years before men do. So understanding where your motivations, there's actually a lot of consistency across the decades, but the altruism one, and also some other key things that are women catching on earlier, variety, intellectual challenge, those show up in women's motivation set the decade before they do for men. And so key things to be thinking about, and this is something I delve into in a chapter of the book also, about those and understanding where you might be changing over time and how that should be affecting a very different path you might take within your venture. So just why do I focus so much on these two motivations, on rich and king? We've seen the last couple of slides. There's the preponderance of them within the motivation set, but then as we've seen at each of those key forks in the road, within these people that you're involving in the venture, about there being that inherent conflict between choose the left fork in the road, I can keep control, but I don't bring the people on that I need to grow the venture, versus bring them on, and I'm going to be having to sacrifice potentially a whole bunch of that control that I have. And to help you, we've developed several resources to help people identify, self-assess around these, also to help them get a feel for a bunch of the other key forks in the road. I think Alana also posted a couple of these, the first two that we have here on the bullet list, about a detailed table of contents, 8 pages worth of those key forks in the road that are tackled there. Also, chapter one that you can go and be able to see that high-level roadmap that sets the table and highlights some of these key preponderant, very consistent issues that are leading to common decisions that lead to perils. But also the third bullet on here, just to highlight for you, that self-assessment survey that will help in 5 minutes. You hop onto there, in 5 minutes you see a bunch of these things that help you identify patterns within your decisions when you're making and you're facing these key forks in the road, making those decisions. They'll help you be able to identify whether there is consistency to it, what does that tell you about yourself and your motivations, and the type of venture you might want to be founding. If there's inconsistency, helping you identify, is that a good thing or not? There are also hybrid paths, some of which are good and some of which can be disastrous if you go down those paths. And then the fourth bullet here, the Kauffman When to Leap video, the sketchbook that I referred to earlier on. And so just to wrap up, the key questions to be thinking about across these key forks in the road, key questions that early on, the more that you can tackle them, the better. There's the key question first, that is the motivations one. There are the options, the key forks in the road that we've seen that have better and worst options, and at the nexus of those two, the key decisions that you're going to be making. So understanding early on the motivations and why am I heading into this, to the extent that you can go and be able to project yourself and be able to figure out if I am facing a trade-off between these two things that I really care about, which one should I be trading off for the other? Understanding those early options that we've delved into two in particular, but where there are a whole slew of them at those forks in the road, where are there going to be problematic decisions that I can be making? Which of those options are going to be in line with it, where I'm looking at a promised land I want to get to, and these are the options that will reinforce it, but instead, which are the options that are going to cause major problems for me as I head down that road? And by doing that, hopefully we'll be able to help you avoid the pitfalls that can sink the team, that are going to potentially cause you to become part of that 65% of ventures that fail because of these people problems and those early decisions that are made, and instead hopefully help you achieve your dreams hopefully have you have that impact on our economy that we all want you to be able to have as you go forward into your founding venture. Okay, let's take a look at any of the questions that people have submitted. Alana, do you want to highlight some of them, or should I go and take them?
Either way, I can tell you that we did have one question about whether you've seen a difference in the performance of ventures based on the legal structure that the founders originally chose.
Okay, so this is one, given that this is not at its core a people problem, it's not anything that I've collected the hardcore data, the 10,000 founders to tackle it, but this is where I have gotten into it within the case study level and understanding from founders all sorts of things that early decisions that cause problems. Oftentimes, there are structures that you can adopt on the legal side that will enable you to be able to deal with uncertainties that you might have. Sometimes you adopt a legal structure that is going to be perfect for a small venture, one that is self-funded, but then as you go forward, as it turns out, you're growing faster than you expected, you're going to be involving more people, you're maybe taking outside money, that then it can be a tough transition to go from that early structure you adopted to one that is going to be able to adjust to your growth and be able to bring other people on board. And that is where there is a price you could be paying for making those early legal decisions, that you're, in some ways we could see it as involving the different person than what we've been talking about, involving a lawyer in your venture. And there are key ways that if this venture is going to face some uncertainties that you should be getting some of that early legal advice, having someone who can plot for you the legal roadmap ahead and can help you understand where you might be making early decisions that could cause you problems. Even some things legally within the founding team, when you're adopting, when you're splitting the equity, if you're having, there's certain things they should be asking questions about in the legal realm, decisions that you have to make within the first month about 83B elections and other things that if you don't do that well early on, that can come back to bite you and cause a major bill for you on the financial side for you to be able to rectify that situation. And so that legal roadmap is definitely something that does have implications for the venture. That founders just understanding the basics early on will hopefully be able to, just by understanding enough of the questions to ask, will hopefully be able to plot key early decisions that aren't going to cause problems down the road also.
Excellent. We did have one other question, and that was about the had to do with getting credit or getting funding for your business in the face of bad credit personally.
Now, when we get into a bunch of the due diligence that potential resource providers are going to be providing for your venture, they are definitely going to be delving into all sorts of dimensions, but those dimensions are going to differ by which type of capital provider it's going to be. When you're looking at one extreme venture capitalist, they're going to be delving into the market potential. They're going to be delving into the team. They're going to have to get a very secure basis, a very secure confidence in each of those, a bunch of the other dimensions that they'll be doing due diligence on. And if you're not going to be able to explain to them why this isn't a red flag within the team, why this isn't something that should be something that is going to cause major questions for them that they're going to be asking if you don't have good answers for them, ways in which you can help them understand how those issues that caused the bad credit have maybe forged you in a better way, ways to understand how you have recovered from that, how that is something that is very much in the past, give them the confidence that it's not going to recur, that this failure has forged a stronger founder rather than being something they should be worried about. That's something you'd have to think through, a bunch of those issues with that person. That potential type of capital provider. Within banks, they're going to be evaluating other things. They won't be looking so much at the upside within the venture. They're going to be looking much more at consistency and getting more of a feel for, are they going to be able to make the interest payments, payment after payment consistently? And if one of the things that they're going to be worried about in the variance is the ups and downs that might have led to that bad credit, that's something they'll be evaluating, and you'll have to be able to explain it to them in a similar way. It's something to be thinking about, a key lens that you have to take of understanding each of these resource providers, even within the hires. When you're going and trying to hire someone, are you going to be able to explain to them why those past bumps in the road have forged a stronger founder rather than are real issues they should be worried about? And so being able to look at the lens that each of these people is going to be taking to you and the venture is a critical thing for being able to recover from that type of an issue that the questioner is asking about.
Noam, I want to thank you so much. This has just been a fabulous and informative hour. I know it's been helpful for all of our presenters, and I want to thank you for joining us for this inaugural event.
Thanks for the opportunity, Elena.
Thank you. I do want to announce that the next in our author series will feature Dr. Monroe Richardson, the Vice President of Education at the Kauffman Foundation. Monroe has a book called What's in Your Cupboard? How to Use What You've Got to Make Meaning and Find Purpose in Your Life. That event will take place on July 11th at 10 a.m. Central, and we will be sending out email invitations shortly. I hope that you'll consider joining us for that. And we want to thank all of you for joining us this morning. Everyone have a great day.